See, first of all, the reason for getting into my research title was child rearing and child mental health, okay? And a study of non-slum families, particularly non-slum, because I think I didn't take this, and it was called elitist research, but for the simple reason that, you know, I worked for 23 years in a school extremely impoverished in terms of money, not in terms of ideas. Sometimes I feel poverty is, the only time poverty is a blessing is when, you know, it leads to great creativity. So we ran a great ship. But the point is that non-slum I didn't take because I saw that here parenting didn't make a big difference. And I was working with severely multiply disabled children, and because they were too busy taking care of roti, kapda aur makan. So where was parenting? So I would have students coming from Tata Institute and said, you know, I took so much trouble for a parent meeting and my father didn't turn up for the meeting. And I said, if he comes to your parent meeting, he's going to lose his day's work, you know. You just tell us what has to be done, they just have to drop the child to school. And somewhere all our interventions or whatever on parenting, whether it's, you know, the so-called LDs and whatever happens, is based on this thing that they need to come for these so-called interventions that we, India Shining, have created. We're not even reaching to 78% of the population, which is not India Shining. Seriously, that's like where basic necessities are not available. These are government reports, okay? Vetted reports, and I have done 10 years of work in this because, like I was telling them, my friend's daughter at 11 jumped off the 7th floor. This was 15 years ago. And she had everything, what we call good parenting today. You know, she had her own room, she had, she would go abroad every week, she went to the best schools, they took her to the club in the evening, yet she killed herself. So people said, how could she be so, you know, and this kind of, I didn't know what a PhD was. I had worked for 25 years and then, you know, my guide said, get into research. So the research that I did was on 1100 mothers across, this was like almost a World Bank study because you don't do more than 100 and 200. So I think you should understand the findings of my study because it's seriously, it's the first of its kind in India, not also abroad, because I looked at this concept of emotional intelligence and resilience. These were two factors that set us apart as Indians. Now, I started off with this feeling of great agitation, and you know, in 2003 when I started my research, you know, I started blaming the parents. I had just come back from my, you know, I went for a Fulbright scholarship 2 years later, so I said, parents are to blame. You know, they didn't know what was needed, it was not the child, why would a 11-year-old kill herself, you know? But my whole point was, I had to blame the parents. And 2 years later when I went to the US on a Fulbright, you know, US was like full of these books, America's Pampered Children, Parents Selling Their Children, Materialism the Great Value, Throw Out the Parents. The blame on parents was huge. So I gave my doctoral proposal to my guide and she says, Lata, you've not done your research. What kind of research is this? You've got to go into the field, get the voices and then come up with your thing. But you know, the only thing that changed, it took me 10 years, of course, because of my caregiving responsibilities. I have two children. I was working at a job. So it took me 10 years. And I'm so glad it took me 10 years. Because today, by the time that 24 or 25 kids get their PhDs in Tata Institute, yes, and IIT, which is ridiculous. You know, they come and tell you how to raise children. You know? And, you know, the only thing that changed in my doctoral proposal, 2003-2010. What do you think changed? The only thing that blame what I had given the parent, that parents are responsible, that was the only thing that changed. The findings were still the same. Children are vulnerable. The only difference was that parents are not to blame because the parents are equally vulnerable. There are no more families raising children. There are only parents raising children, parents who are lost completely. I don't know if you've read Frank Lebon, The Crowd. You know, they're doing because somebody else is going to the mall, so I have to take my child to the mall. And they come to me, you know. I did a, one of the biggest schools in Bombay, I did a session with them some time back. And you know, there were 7 people interviewing me for a 40-minute session. So then they said, you know, leave half an hour for questions and answers. I said, see, you're calling me because I'm the so-called expert on parenting. What questions are the parents going to ask me? Let me give them the information. They will decide then. So they said, okay ma'am, no questions and all, you know. Because you know what kind of questions I'll get, no? I'll get learning disabilities, I'll get autism. How many people have these problems? Hyperactivity, where were all these 20 or 30 years ago? You know, today I'm dealing with, that's why I gave up counseling, because it doesn't work. These are first, we are a society which first creates problems. And then, you know, there's this 5% population or 10% population will run to the therapist. Even these will stop because it's time consuming. Nobody has the time today. 70% of parents' time today is spent online. Forget children. They're not able to manage lives, their own personal lives. So when I talked to them, they said, you know, what are you going to talk about? So everything was vetted, looked through, because this was one of those, you know, India Shining Schools again. So they had to look at everything. So I said, can you give us strategies and tips on how to raise the children? I said, I'm sorry, because there are no strategies. I'm here just for attitudinal change, because you know your child the best. How can I tell you how to raise your child? I can't give you blanket strategies, because some child, you know, children go to sleep at 12 o'clock. We are a sleep-deprived nation. Next day they're sleeping in school. We're breaking their biorhythm. Cyber cafes in Tata Institute, I get into a lot of trouble. Okay, I'm very controversial. I'm major moral policing. But I'm saying, 24 hours you keep the cyber cafe open. At 10 o'clock in the night, average, they go in and come out at 6 o'clock. You know, I took a 4-day workshop at Tata Institute recently. The children, they were sleeping in class. And I'm phenomenal as a teacher. But they couldn't hold up, you know. It's not that my lectures were boring or something. They'd walk in at 2 o'clock for a 9 to 3 class and it was allowed. So my whole point is, one is resilience and one is this whole breakdown. You know, children are bright. The IQ is fantastic. They'll come out of IIMA and everything, gold medalist. But the father who's also an IIT will tell me, if there is a crisis, they don't know what to do. They seriously don't know what to do. So as Indians who are supposed to be the brightest in the world, I'm saying this because in 1750, India and China, our GDP was 60% of the world's GDP. Check this, Angus Madison reports, OECD, not written by some local guy. We were 67% of the world's GDP pre-colonization. 1950, we become 1.6, China becomes 6%. 100,000 schools in each residency, Madras, Kolkata. You must read this book. Anybody who's with children, Dharampal's book, 10 years. He was so impressed with what Gandhi said to the king. He went and researched Gandhi's work. He's written a beautiful book. It's online. You get it available. It's called The Beautiful Tree. You must read this book. Just to know the wealth, not wealth as in money, that was there. In terms of education, we had 100,000 schools in each of the residencies in four areas, okay? This interested me because I'm wondering, why did this happen? You know, when I first heard this, when did this 200 years of colonization that left us here? Because I have students now, I have corporates, I work with corporates on work-life balance. And because most of them are seriously dying at 40. Or, you know, diabetes, cholesterol, seriously. So parents have these issues. How will they bring in resilience or, you know, emotional intelligence in their children? So it's not about ADHD or autism. And I get very agitated because children form 40 to 45% of our population. That's huge. And neither in this, I was interacting with IIT Mumbai, Delhi University, Tata Institute, last 1 month. Nobody talks of children and families. We have elections. Is anybody talking of child well-being? We talk of mental health. LD is a big thing. Recently, a leading psychiatrist says, drop maths and science. What do we want to make our children? Obese? 3 out of 5 children are obese in the United States. 300 million are... 300 million sounds a little more, no? Whatever, it's a large thing. And please read Spengler about how we drive our children crazy. They're on medication for hyperactivity. Just simply, this is legislation, no? They were told to give these medications, right, Alan? And these are all documented. If you check the UNICEF reports, I wanted to, that's what, you know, those are figures post-colonization. 100,000 schools in each residency, and at that time, Britain had only 2 years of schooling at the same time. You know, today we are talking of feminism, discrimination, oppression. Native Americans reduced to 3% of the population. Human rights, does anybody study them? I mean, when children today are going into a system that is, you know, in the West, they did a study of the rich industrialized country, UNICEF, recent study, two studies, one on materialism, And this, the UK report commissioned this because they did 21 countries, UNICEF report, recent one, please check it out. USA and UK come 19th and 20th, the last two in every six indicators. And they didn't call it mental health because these are pathology models introduced by the West because it has to cater to the drug and service industry. And US has 14 and 15 children dying, this was in 2005, okay? 14 and 15 children dying of gun violence every week. And they tell us about discrimination, oppression, and we are having feminism problems. I wrote to Bill Gates, I said, clean your backyard first. But, you know, very happily, you know, they said, no, we can't pass this on to Mr. Gates, but this is the issue. To get back 19th and 20th. So UK got very flat, you know, we are last on the table. So they set up another study, two of their people, and they realized that this whole concept of materialism that UK and US and not the other European countries sell has become a concept today. So today, from a nation of craftsmen, traders, entrepreneurs, we have converted them into clerks and peons. That was the British agenda, and they've succeeded. Because 30 years ago, when I used to teach, I'd ask the students, what is it that you want to become? And they'd come up with great lofty ideals. I want to change society. I want to become a doctor. Today also, they want to become a doctor, but that is for the other reasons. But today, if I ask them, you know what they tell me? I want a three-bedroom flat in Malabar Hill. I want a rich wife. I want a rich husband. I want a shopping cart in Mango. I don't know what Mango is that time. They said Mango is so, you know, kind of this thing. But they want a shopping account in life. 20 years from now, where do you see yourself? And then I deal with the other problems, no? Because loneliness, depression. I'm dealing with nine-year-olds with vitamin deficiency because they're going from an AC home to an AC school to an AC lobby to an AC bus. Yeah. And then the horror of all horrors. They go to an AC playground. Playground as in, you know, these wonderful structured play activities. That's why one passion is unstructured play. Because I feel 90% of our problems with children today will get sorted out if they were sent to play. No child plays today. No children. Only the slum children play. They're lucky. These people, even that rain day or whatever we have in these fancy schools, it's like a Bollywood rain sequence. They'll wet them out for like 10 minutes. And that is your display. And you know, when I went to the US, I was in UNT where we did play therapy. And 20 years ago, what we did in Sevadan, the school that I worked in with poor children, water play, sand play, we had done it all long back. You know, to give you a simple, we had common sense wisdom. Why have we turned out so good today? Because, see, today children are being outsourced. Why is there so little of emotional? That time also we outsourced. Our parents didn't even know which class. My father didn't know which class I was in. My mother didn't know English. So what studies would she take? But we outsourced them to peers. We had friends. We had neighbors. I mean, we had multiple mothers caregiving. You know, you ate in your neighbor ate in your house, but you ate in your neighbor's house. We used to take food there. We used to, you know, exchange. Today, they don't know who lives next door. I had these three groups, no? And the upper middle class, I mean, didn't even know who lived next door. And I'm dealing with vitamin D deficiency problems, child having fractures 8 years. But the mother says, I can't change that school timing. And so she gives her vitamin D injections. I'm dealing with porn as young as fourth standard. Parents call me frantically, what do I do? My son came to ask me today, fourth standard child, what is a blue film? Because, you know, somebody told him, I'll download it in your app. So I said, in the fourth standard, he has a cell phone. You be ready for the consequence. I don't tell you don't give a cell phone because they come and say, everybody has a cell phone, so what can I do? I'm just giving you the consequences. You make your choice because that's why I gave up counseling. It didn't work. So that my whole thing is this breakdown in emotional intelligence, I feel comes in, you know, what you bring up, is because that we are not raising children anymore. They've been outsourced to the media. And just to end and make you all really scared, because I like it when people go back scared because then we'll do something about it. Comfort zones are a problem for me. Is that 57% of UK's children, when asked who they want to be in, you know, when they grow up, Mr. and Mrs. Beckham. At least Beckham is a footballer. But posh spice has given rise to a disease called poshitis. It's serious, okay? Because there is this big tote bag, which she's the brand ambassador of. And you know, the amount, you know, women tend to put everything into their bags. So they carry it. And that bag is done so it's big. And you're carrying a toddler all the time. 10.5 kilos of weight you're carrying. And you see it, it's very popular among the youngsters. And that bag is designed so that your legs look slim, you know, against it. But that is called poshitis. So we have another drug industry there. There's therapy and there is massage and to take care of the spinal problems or whatever.